pick that up.
We're definitely demasking now for the purposes of the filming.
Yeah, you can, yeah.
There's going to be a point about that later on. My name is Darrell Markewitz, and I've been an artisan blacksmith now professionally for about 35 years. And I've been operating at a thing called Wareham Forge since the early 1990s. And as you might guess, working as an artisan blacksmith, although design is an important component of the work that I do, usually they're commissioned pieces, which means we have dictates in design that are caused by the customer's requirements. Architectural projects, obviously, you know, this building codes to consider things like that. So I've been fortunate to be involved with the Elora Sculpture Project now for about 5-6 years. I've had a piece accepted every year, which I consider to be quite exceptional. And I'm particularly proud of this year's entry. As has been the case for the last couple of years, there's a very strong ecological component to this. But the piece itself came together extremely well. Now, there's a number of technical things that combine to the, what I feel is the success of this piece. The materials here are very, very aggressively hand-forged. And about the only elements that haven't been altered from the original profile stock are some of the round stocks, which of course have been still sculpted and are tapered at the ends. The major stem pieces are made of C-shaped channel, and the leaves and the cores are all made of angle iron. So it's hard to go back from the original starting materials to what the final product is, which I consider really, really important when you're converting the techniques of blacksmithing to create a sculptural artistic piece. One of the other important aspects of this piece for me from a technical standpoint is the use of bright, bright colors. Forged modern steels are a medium gray color with a flat finish with a bit of texture to it when they come out of the fire. But the problem is all our modern materials will rust when exposed to the environment. And I deliberately played with that the last couple of entries I've done for the sculpture project by leaving surfaces unpainted and allowing them to rust naturally. The truth is most people will take their forge work and paint it black. That's not really the color of the material that comes out of the forge. So in truth, the bright greens or fire engine red are just as honest as black paint is. In this case, I deliberately chose two really, really bright industrial colors, a green, like a Holland tractor green, and international yellow as the basis. And then these colors have been slightly modified by using spray enamel paints to highlight. And that's a fairly quick way to actually add a lot of extra inches. Like you see, there's actually three different colors used to the stamen part of each one of these seed buttons. This piece took me about a month to do at the rate I work anyway, between the design and the actual fabrication. One of the aspects that other blacksmiths will get a kick out of is some of these individual stem elements are about 6 feet long. And working by yourself, that means standing here and hammering there and trying to control the shape generation while you're doing that. It's a beautiful process. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, there's a very, very profound ecological message here. The full title of this piece is An Undiscovered Plant Containing a Cure for Cancer. And the concept of this was generated by a film that's from the late 1980s called Medicine Man, Rashad Connery. And it tells the story of a research scientist in the Amazon who discovers a cure for cancer. At the same time, a logging concern is in the process of destroying the forest and the very plants that the cure comes from. And I was quite shocked to find out recently that clear cutting and burning of the Amazon over the last year of COVID has in fact accelerated, not declined. COVID itself is a story about human encroachment into a jungle environment. You cut down the trees, the creatures that live there suddenly are impacted with humans. And many of those creatures have diseases which we can catch. This is exactly where COVID-19 came from. So remember that what we're experiencing day by day is in fact an example of environmental destruction and the tipping point that we all are living with right this instant. I'm not personally involved in any upfront organizational approach to environmental problems. When I was a kid back in the early 70s, I was involved in the ecological movement. And the truth is, in 1972, we knew this was happening. This is not a surprise to anybody who's paying attention. Curiously enough, I spent a lot of time working with experimental archaeology, particularly related to the Viking Age. And one of the first indications I had that there was a major environmental problem we were experiencing in global warming was a thing that was on Peter Zosky's program, Warning Sign, back in the early 1990s. And they were talking about discovering absolutely perfect 8,000-year-old spears up in the Yukon. And there was an ice pan that didn't melt in the summertime. And because it didn't melt, it was cold, and mosquitoes didn't want it. And because there were no mosquitoes, the caribou knew about this. Well, the native people living in that area also knew the caribou were there. But because the snow was kind of rotten, they would throw a spear, and if they missed, it would get buried in the snow. Those spears were melting out after 8,000 years, and this was an archaeological story. Well, the question is, after 8,000 years, why is the ice melting? There's a problem right now in my studies in the Viking Age, the rising sea levels and the change in current patterns are eroding away archaeological sites that have been buried for 1,000 years on the coastline. So all these little things are all coming home to play to us right now.
Great.
So I've been so concerned about some of this stuff of late. On a normal year, I would spend about $2,000 on gasoline for various traveling. And I've been making trips overseas every second year, primarily to work in Scotland on a special life project. And obviously the last year, my gas consumption went down from $2,000 a year to $200. And we're certainly not making any airplane trips.
Right.
And that probably represents my single largest impact on the climate in general. And I'm becoming concerned enough about this that I certainly will probably right. never go into an airplane again.
Yeah.
And probably not repeat any of the kind of travel. The truth is, the people that already recognize this problem will only agree with the message. Those that most need to change are the least likely to do anything. And I think of the people I see up in front of my house in rural Dundalk every weekend up from the city on their quad runners, and what that implies about gross consumerism and this being considered to be a way to experience the out of world. I've been active on the internet pretty much since it started, and my website was Wareham Forge, WareHamForge.ca, contains not only a survey of my own work, but information that other people interested in pursuing metalwork would find interesting, and extensive documentation in my experimental archaeology series on Bloomery Ironstone.